So far, any doubts on this setup here? If you have any doubts on this setup, just ask me now. So that is, it is assigning, it could be arbitrarily, right? You are just assuming that there is some phenomena according to which these losses are generated, which you don't know, okay? Your goal is to now select an action here which would have given the smallest loss. So, okay, just to rewind this. So, in every round, environment is coming up with this loss vector, right? At the end of n rounds, so this is the loss you incur if you happen to play always the ith action, right? We are just saying that, okay, I do not have any control over how this environment is generating the losses, but I want to play an action on which the loss assigned by the environment is the smallest. So this is the total loss assigned to action I by the environment, right? I am just trying to take the smallest one. So what we are saying in the setup is, see, I do not have any control over how these losses are being assigned to action. I would pick an action which gives me the smallest total loss. I will take it as my benchmark. It can keep changing. That is why we are indexing by subscript t, right? If t changes, this vector could change.
Xti.
Yeah.
Then you are saying that we are setting a ith action on which the losses are minimum.
No, I am looking at, you take one I, look at the loss I get on that action.
In all the rounds,
summed over all the rounds. And now I am looking at an action on which this sum is the smallest. Yeah. So maybe just to make this concrete, let's take you three guys sitting in this column. Like, let's say in every class, I will come up with some numbers for you guys according to my own criteria. Assign this value, 2, 3, and I keep on doing it for let's say 10 days. So the number assigned for you, let's say it's the score for you. Now, somebody who don't know how I am assigning scores to you, but he would like to pick one among you to whom possibly I am going to assign the highest score total in total sum. If he has to figure out how he is going to do that, like the guy who is going to get the maximum score, right, like the total sum, if you want to identify, he would be that would be your best choice. That is the best student, let's say, among three of you. If I want to identify the best, this is what I want to do. But I don't know a priori, right, like how I'm going to assign this. And this assignment process it is up to me how I assign. And any of you don't know about it. Now, how you are going to select? That's what this setup is telling you. Minimum? No. I am saying over the entire round, I am basically talking about single best action for the entire round, right? If you are allowing, okay, fine. If you want to take this min inside this summation, what you are looking is the smallest score in each round, right? So, right now I have not gone into that. But that situation is harder to handle. That means you could have done that. Okay, so what he's saying is, okay, let me write this. why not consider this, right? Okay, now let's, okay, just I want to again write that quantity here. You understand the difference between these two criteria now? All of you. So, what we are doing is when I am looking into this, my criteria, I am looking at the single best action throughout. But if you take the minimum inside, what I am looking at in each round, I am looking at the smallest value. And because of that, it is not necessary that in each round I would be playing the same guy. So, which criteria is good? First one is more stringent, right? You want to see in each round what is the smallest. So, if you could do that, it may happen that in one particular route, I may assign him 3, I may assign him 2, and I may assign him 1. In this round, he got the smallest value. But in the next round, I may assign him 0, I may assign him 4, and I may assign him 2. So, now in the second round, this guy got the smallest value. So, in that way, in this criteria is asking, go and choose the best action in each round. That is the benchmark. But often it so happens that this criteria is very hard to compete against. We are always, so this is what we are saying, this is what we incur, and this is what we are competing. This is our benchmark strategy, right? In this case, playing the single arm always is a benchmark, and in this case, playing the best in each round is the benchmark. But this benchmark always happens to be hard to deal with yourself. Okay? Okay, now let's, is there a relation between this quantity and this quantity? Right now, we don't putting any constraint on how this XTIs are generated, right? As a special case, it could be cyclic as is telling. So, for example, let's say, let's take k equals to 3, and in this case, my xt first in x1 is 1, 2, 3, and x2 is 3, 1, 2, and x3 is, what is that after one more cycle, 2, 3, 1. You understand this? So, the environment is assigning this, and then again x4 becomes equals to x1. It could be in this cyclical fashion. So, with this, if you are going to look at a single best, yeah, so fine. If you have such a specific sequences, if you are saying, okay, I am not learning anything by this one, in this case, this criteria is better. Okay? But as I am telling, this is fine. This is when we have such a special sequence, but a priori you do not know anything about how the sequence is being generated, right? For an arbitrary sequence, giving any performance guarantees with such is very hard. Whereas, if you look at comparing against a single best action, we will be able to say something. Okay? This is indeed a stronger benchmark, but it also will, it is not much tractable, we cannot say much about this, but we will be able to say much about this. Okay, for time being, assume that these XTs are randomly generated. Okay, it could be something, but some random values. Can I say something about this and this? Expectation of minimum of random variables and minimum of the expectation. Which one is greater? This guy is going to be smaller than this guy, right? Because you are taking expectation of the pathwise minimum. This is going to be minimum expectation. So, because this is smaller, but this is coming with a negative sign. Okay, so which is going to be larger? What will be the relation? So this is going to be like this, right? And what we have defined our regret to be, actually our, we have defined this to be our regret. This is the expected regret. What we ideally would have liked to give a bound on this, right? This is what here we are interested in. But if this is going to be, if I allow this x I to be random, then this relationship holds. And we will see that later, when I allow this x t i's to be random, I will only be interested in bounding this, not this. Then, and that time we are going to call it as pseudo regret. So, right, as long as sequence is given to you, it's fine. If the sequence are random, then comparing against a single best action will be lower bound on this, in this fashion. Okay, so this we will again revisit when we are going to talk about stochastic bandits, where we allow this loss to be drawn according to some distribution. Here we are saying this XTIs could be stochastic or it could be arbitrarily generated. Okay, I mean stochastic in the sense they follow some particular distributions, or they did not follow any distributions. Okay, so this we call as pseudo regret. Okay, fine. Now the question is, what is the algorithm? Yeah, right. This one here, for a given sequence, this expectation has no meaning, right? If you give me the sequence xt, this is a fixed quantity, whereas this quantity is random because your it is random. So I mean I could as well not write expectation here. Okay, but now what we are saying is, if this xtis are random or stochastic, you are assuming that this is not a particular sequence, but this is some stochastically generated sequence according to some arbitrary distribution, and not necessarily in IID fashion or anything, it could be in arbitrary fashion, then this expectation here is also valid because the sequence is random now. In which case, if I am going to look at the single best action as my benchmark, then this becomes a lower bound on this. Is this point clear? Okay, maybe what is confusing here is this given sequence. So in that case, maybe I don't need to write an expectation here. Whereas if I allow this xt to be a stochastic, then this holds. Is this clear? Okay. Then in this case, this expectation involves two level of randomness here, right? When I allow this xt to be stochastic, these are random, and also the selection of it is random. So this expectation is over randomness of losses and arm selection. So the randomness of losses is by the adversary, that is the environment, and the arm selection is by the learner. So you are basically taking average over the distributions of both environment as well as the learner. Whereas in this part, we have removed learner, right? We are just trying to see what is the best thing we can get. We only take the expectation with respect to the randomness of this loss values. Okay. Right, this should be exterior. Yeah. No. Because we are taking minimizing it or all possible i's, right?
So in one round we will set one i, second round another
i. It could be depending on what is the value of this xt. Okay. Again, let me revisit these things. We are saying the environment in each round is going to generate a loss vector, and then the learner is going to pick an action. Okay, and the learner is going to pick an action according to policy. That policy will be based on the past history that he has observed. Okay, this is the observation the learner has made. Now, this policy may be, this policy maybe I should also write it as a function of xt, because now this regret is defined for a given sequence. Is that clear? Now, if for a given sequence, this is the loss you have incurred for playing it, okay, and this is what the best you could have got. So, that is why I said, maybe again I will write, maybe so this is the regret I got, but still this is, even though this is for a given sequence, this regret is still random, right? Because the learner is randomizing his strategy. Okay. So I would maybe, I may want to look at the expected value of this, but still for this given sequence. So that is exactly this value. That is, only this part is random. So I am going to take the expectation of this, but this part there is no randomness. Once you give me the sequence, there is no randomness in this quantity, and this is the expected regret. So because of this, having expectation here has no meaning, right? Because this is for a given sequence, I could get rid of this expectation as well. So these things are clear here. All this confusion arised when I wrote expectation here, and the question was whether this expectation and minimization were interchangeable here. Okay. Now assume instead of xt sequence is given, this xt sequence is stochastic. Okay. So, because stochastic, I am going to write it as capital Xt, because now the loss vector assigned in each round is a random quantity. So, this quantity is now going to be Xt It, and now this is Xt It, and this is Xt It. Okay. Now, instead of looking this regret for a given sequence xt, now I am allowing this xt to be arbitrary, then what we will get? This is going to be r of n pi expected value. And notice that I am now no more writing it as xt, because that sequence is I am not considering a fixed sequence, but I am considering stochastic sequence now. Yeah. Okay. It is the same thing what I have written here, but instead of a fixed sequence, I am allowing this, taking this XTs to be stochastic. So, fine. I am just saying this is what, when from this, when I went here, when I allowed my XTs to be random, this is the quantity, right, finally. So, this is expectation. I have also taken expectation of this because my XTs are random. But here this sequence XT is, yeah. Here it is remained same, in the secant same. So, I am just saying this happens because it is not the same, they are not equal. What is the relation? Here it is stochastic. Right, because of this, you have expectation of this minimum, right. Now, if you are going to, so what is this? I could write this as this quantity here as also expectation of, sorry, summation of expectation of minimum, if I take expectation inside. Now, expectation of minimum of xi, it is going to be greater than this. Okay, so maybe you guys are still confused. Let me rewrite this. Okay, let me rewrite this. Okay, expectation of t equals to 1 to n xt it minus t equals to 1 to n expectation of minimum of I xt I. This is fine. Now, I will just leave it like this. Now, minus this quantity, instead of expectation of minimum of this, if I write it as minimum of I expectation of xti, what it will be? This is going to be. Okay, so this is still, now can I go back to this step? This step is what? I mean, this I can always rewrite it as minimum of I or I could as well write it as is this clear? So, we have just doing this manipulation here. Now, so this is equal now this was looking at the minimum quantity in every round, but now what it is looking at? It is looking at the single action which is giving me minimum over the all the rounds. So, and this is going to be actually lower bound on this. Okay. What we actually wanted is we defined this to be our regret. Okay, but this regret is often too demanding. The benchmark here is too demanding. In each round, I want to find the minimum loss. But here, if I do some manipulation, I will end up with this. Here my benchmark is to look at the single best action for the entire n rounds. But this is a lower bound, it's fine, but we will take this as our regret definition. And we call this as I wrote earlier, pseudo regret. We call it pseudo regret. I mean, see, like what we just the whole business of getting confused here happened because we first defined this regret for a given sequence, and then we wanted to take the expected value. So this expected regretters was like this. But had we allowed, instead of a sequence, particular sequence, if we are allowed for any probabilistic sequence, we will end up with this definition. But this definition requires this stringent benchmark. Instead of that, we can go and consider this benchmark, which is like a weaker version of this. Okay. I would have liked to come to this ideally a bit later, but now you have asked this, we kind of clarified this. Is there any confusion now on what is an expected regret and what is a pseudo regret here? That is fine, right? In the expected regret, we have this benchmark which is a bit stringent. Okay, now let us come back to, by the way, we should call this adversarial bandit setting, not just bandit setting. So, we will just discuss the main idea that we are going to use in this setup and then talk the algorithm and its proof in the next class. Okay, fine. In the weighted majority, we got to know the laws for all the actions, and what we did, we updated the weights for each of the actions, right, according to some exponential factors. So, there we were able to update the weights for all the actions in each round, because we have observation for all the actions. But now in the bandit setting, we have observation for only the action we played, but not for the other actions. Now how I am going to update, is it that in each round I am only going to update the action that I played and not update anything about the other actions, or that is there a mechanism that I update all the weights in each round? Okay. So, we will see that it, even though we do not observe losses for the actions which we do not play, but we can pretend to come up with a mechanism where we will say that we have some information about the other arms even though we did not observe them, and accordingly update their weights. So, what is that mechanism? That mechanism is called as important sampling. Let us say so, PT is the distribution with which you select the arms in each round. So, we said arms are selected according to some distribution, right, and the policy governs what is the distribution. Let us say in round T, this is the distribution according to which you are going to select an action. Now, that is, you are going to select IT according to distribution PT. So, we are going to select one of these. Suppose, let us say you happen to select IT equals to I in round T, and then you observe XTI as your loss for this action, and you do not observe anything for the other actions. Okay. Now, how to update the weights for all the actions. Okay. Let's say I am going to define this quantity called the estimates for the loss. I'm going to define it maybe I should write. I am going to define the estimates in round T. The environment chooses this actor xt. Okay. What I am going to do is I am going to estimate the value that environment chooses in round t by some mechanism, and I am writing that values to be in this fashion. Okay. So this is my estimator for the loss observed on round on arm J in round T. Okay. So how I am defining this? XTJ divided by PTJ, IT equals to J. Okay. So suppose now let's say if you have played IT equals to I in the Tth round. For what is this quantity is going to be? So let's say, so this quantity, how this is going to be? If it equals to I, xti upon pti for I, and for what happens for j not equals to I? Going to be, what is that? Indicator, yes, the indicator. So this is how I am estimating the values of the loss in round T. I am saying that if I observe, if I have played action I know the value xti because I observed that, and I define its estimate to be xti by pti. For the other guys, I just define it to be 0. Okay, this is what this definition is saying, that. Okay. Now the question is, and this is an estimator for the loss values. The question is why this estimator? Okay. So now let's try to see, is this estimator here is a random quantity? Yes, why? Because it depends on IT, which is selected randomly in that round, right? Okay. Now let's take expected value of, maybe because this is a random quantity, maybe I will write it as capital XT. Okay, so this is an estimator, which is, now this is what this quantity, I'm going to just write it as cap here, Tj. What is the expected value of this? If you want to compute the expected value of this, this is going to be, so this is the random quantity, right? I'm going to looking expectation with respect to IT. So this is going to be x tj and this is now summation over I. I equals to 1 to k. So now I am allowing this I, it can takes value I which is going from 1 to k, right? And now this has to be multiplied with p t I, right? This is the probability with which it is equals to I is p t I. Is this expected value correct? Okay. Now simplify this. Only when I is equals to j, this indicator remains. For all others, it is going to be 0, right? So what is this quantity to be? This quantity turns out to be xtj divided by ptj into when I is j is ptj, which is xtj. So this estimator is such that the expected, its expected value is exactly the sample value in that round. Even though you may only have observed xti in that round, but if you are going to define your estimators like this, even for every, this is true for all j. So for every component, you have an unbiased estimator. So you understand what I mean by unbiased estimator? What is an unbiased estimator? The expectation of the estimator is the same as the of what? The value which we are estimating. Okay. So here this guy, what it was, whatever its quantity, this is, if you are assuming that this quantity is trying to estimate the true value, that is xtj in round j, this is exactly, it is in expectation, it is doing that job. So this estimator here is an unbiased estimator. Now you see that if you forget about this estimator, in every round you kind of have values for each of, you have predicted or predicted each component which are a good estimators for the true values. Even though you do not know the true values, but you have a mechanism in which you are able to estimate those unknown quantities for which your estimations are pretty much, they are unbiased. So can you now use them in your learning as you did in the full information case? So in the full information case, you had information about, you have observed the loss for all the actions. So you are using them to update all the actions. But here you only observed loss for one action, but you, for everybody else, you have these estimators, but these estimators in expectation as good as the true values which you did not observe. So maybe, yes, I do not have true observe, but I have this value observe which could act as a proxy for the true losses, and I can use them to update all my weights for all the actions, right? So we will use this idea to come up with an algorithm for adversarial bandit algorithm called EXP3, that we will do it in the next class.